Hello, everyone, and good afternoon. I share Yemisi's enthusiasms for the opportunity we have in sharing this day with you here at GBH. I'm John Abbott, President and CEO of this organization, and here with many of my colleagues and teammates, grateful to be a partner with King Boston in the Embrace Ideas Festival. Welcome to day four of King Boston's remarkable festival. It's been such an amazing week, and we're honored to be a part of it. I've been just moved by the stories of attendees and the speakers they've heard, the conversations they've been part of. It is so encouraging because I have been familiar with the vision for this festival from Imari for a long time, and I can imagine his excitement and that of all of the King Boston family that these days are here and this is launched. Our vision here at GBH is to be a service-driven public media organization that responds to, represents, and includes the diversity of our community. GBH is your public media station, and we are committed to including your voices and your stories. This is true all around the country. Actually, the public media organization in every city, in every town of this country, is the last locally owned, operated, and governed media in this country. Together, we work in a spirit of purpose and mission, aligning ourselves, hopefully, with the progress that we hope to see as in all of our communities, together with remarkable collaborating organizations. We share King Boston's goal of dismantling structural racism and cultivating the conditions necessary for racial and economic justice in Boston and in our Commonwealth. Today's featured topic, reparations, is a critically important one as Boston considers local reparations efforts. I look forward very much to hearing the ideas that are put forth and discussed by the advocates on today's panels as we work together to build the new Boston that we aspire to. And now it is my extreme pleasure to turn it over to my friend Imari Paris Jeffries, Executive Director of King Boston, to get us started. Imari.
I was waiting for my walkout music, but they play something slow and sad. So I might need a redo. I'm gonna sit back down and I'm gonna get a redo. All right, let's try it again, Val.
Funky.
All right, much better. Y'all want to see me dance to this song?
Nasty.
Greg says no. Greg says no. All right, but I'm gonna say no. I think my mother's gonna say no. Thank you all for being here today, and thank you all who are tuning in online in the live stream. We're so excited to have you here on day four. Thank you to my friends, John Abbott and Liz Chang, and the entire host team at GBH. Let's give it up for this incredible day and this incredible space. If you have been here all week, welcome back. And if this is your first day, we are so glad to have you here today. We are ready to learn something new, meet someone new, and share and embrace with one another. Embrace Ideas Festival represents 5 days of embracing one another, embracing our city, embracing ideas, and embracing that we are in this together. Uprooting the zero-sum game that has us deeply believing, that progress for one group must come at the expense of another. Yesterday, we explored the power of symbols, monuments, memorials, and the role of culture in building vibrant communities. Today, we'll explore the repairing damages of the past that must be part of changing New Boston today and into the future. Our keynote conversation with longtime reparations advocate and leader and former chair of the National Coalitions for Blacks and Reparations in America, Cam Howard, who's sitting right there. Let's give it up for Cam. I'm so excited to hear from you, Cam. And then we're joined later today by friends from around the country, including here in Boston, who are leading local reparations efforts that are creating tangible impact in their communities. These include my friend and mentor, Dr. Jemadari Kimara of the University of Massachusetts, Boston. Cheryl Evans Davis, the Executive Director of the San Francisco Human Rights Commission. Dr. Emilcar Shabazz, UMass Amherst Professor and member of the Amherst African Heritage Reparation Assembly. And finally, Robin Rue Simmons, former alderman of Evanston, Illinois, who helped create the country's first local reparations initiative and now executive director of First Repair. Then we'll hope you stay through the early evening to enjoy music from Amandi Music, one of our artists in residence, as well as a special premiere screening of Mass Humanities film, What to the Slave is the 4th of July, so inspired by Frederick Douglass. And before we get started, I'd like to do a bit of thanks. I'm so humbled and grateful for all of the support that we've gotten to make this week possible. Our major underwriter, the Mellon Foundation, for the generosity in helping this week happen. To our festival sponsors, including the City of Boston, the Boston Foundation, Harvard Medical School, Mass General Brigham's, State Street, PNC Bank, the ICA, GBH, and Mass College of Art and Design. Our premier sponsors, including United Way of Mass Bay and Merrimack Valley, Stop and Shop, Converse Nike, Castle Group, and the Boston Globe. And we'd like to thank our speakers, our culture sponsors, and community sponsors highlighted in the slideshow above me. To our community members all week, including the City of Boston's Office of Resilient Cities, the Huntington Theater Company, Deloitte, Boston While Black, the Boston Children's Chorus, a lot of folks in this community make this happen, BAMS Fest, Black Market Nubian, Jazz Urbane, Boston Ballet, Global Citizens Council, Roxbury Film Festival, and the Boston Public Library. To our board of advisors and our three co-chairs, Reverend Jeffrey Brown, Reverend Liz Walker, and Paul English. And finally, special shout out to the King Boston team. And so if you're a King Boston team member, temporary or permanent, raise your hand. Let's give it a clap up for them. We got some temporary King Bostoners in here. To GBH, today's media sponsors, who will be streaming this live event. Let's give it up to the GBH team, all the team members who made this day possible. And as we think about good energy, I know we got a lot to, we're learning a lot, we're absorbing a lot. Let's save at least 2% of our energy to will the Celtics into a game 7. So only 2%. I think if everyone gives 2%, it'll equal 100. And so thank you for having us here today. We have a lot to go over, and to our moderator of this next panel, our deputy director, Tammy Tai, of course. Clap it up for Tammy. And thank you so much. I'm going to turn it back over to Yemisi. Thank you so much.
Okay, yes, we have to will the Celtics to win because Ime is Nigerian. So that's another one. That's another one. Well, thank you again. I wanted, before I introduce the illustrious panel, I want to share a quick story. I've been at GBH for a year, and you could read more about all the things that we're doing on gbh.org. But a couple of years ago, I'm Nigerian, as I mentioned, but I married an African-American male. And so a few years ago, I took him to Nigeria, and we visited the point of no return. And immediately with my family, and it didn't hit me the same way because my family came here willingly, but it hit him, and he turned around and started profusely crying and saying, "You are so lucky. You know where you are from." Then it hit me, the privilege that I have with my Nigerian identity, the privilege that I have with my language, the privilege that I have with my culture, my food, my clothing. The transatlantic slave trade began in the 15th century. More than 3.5 million slaves were shipped from Nigeria to North and South America. Today's discussion will frame the need for local reparations to redress these crimes against humanity, identify specific areas of full repair, and help us learn from other cities that are undertaking reparative justice. Together, we can, not we will, we can, and we will, move forward that repairs historic policy harms against Black communities in Boston. So with this, I am so honored to introduce to you Tammy Tai, Deputy Director of King Boston, who will lead our keynote discussion. Tammy Tai, you can start walking so you can get your music.
Girl is
doesn't she get music? There you go.
Kids tell me I have to retire that song,
Tammy,
but we'll do for now.
I still have more to say about Tammy. She brings over two decades of experience in the nonprofit sector with expertise in youth development and mentoring and leadership development and racial equity. She has a BA in sociology from Harvard University and an MBA from the Heller School of Social Policy and Management at Brandeis University. Welcome, Tammy.
Thank y'all.
And Cam Howard, you got your music coming on, right?
It's time.
Oh, I love that. Wow. Okay, so Cam Howard is Executive Director of Reparations United and a former co-chair of the National Coalitions of Blacks for Reparations in America and COBRA. He is a Chicago-based real estate investor and an internationally respected reparations activist. As a member of the National African American Reparations Commission, also known as NARC, Cam led a team to revise H.R. 40, the federal reparations bill. He recently authored a pamphlet, Laying the Foundation for Local Reparations, a guide for providing national symmetry for local reparations efforts. And in June of 2020, Cam successfully led the work to pass the City of Chicago Subcommittee on Reparations. This is his first visit to Boston, so give him a warm welcome. Over to you, Tam.
All right, thank you. Clap it up for Yemisi. Thank you. And she told me the outfit was sent specifically from Nigeria for today. So thank you. Thank you all. So Cam, thank you. I feel it's a little bit fangirl right here. Like Cam is a celebrity within the reparations movement. And I think I shared with you, Cam, the first time I laid eyes on you was through a Zoom screen. You were presenting for Race Forward, and I said, I need to know this person. And it's such an honor to have you physically sitting here right next to us. So just thank you. And thank you for welcoming in King Boston and all of our allies into this movement, right? So, you know, King Boston, y'all know we're early in our work, right? But reparations is a deep piece of what we want to move. And so we're early in our work, but you welcomed us in, and all the ways that you've mentored and supported me and the team. So I just wanna thank you for that, because I think that's emblematic of who you are and how you lead. So just thank you, thank you.
Thank you, Tammy.
And again, welcome to Boston. We can't believe this is Cam's first time here. So thank you.
I've traveled a lot around the country, but this is my first time in Boston.
Well, good, so, and we have to make sure we treat Cam well. And so I'm so excited for this conversation. I mean, yeah. I think you were the first who said yes probably 5 months ago,
right,
when we were thinking about this festival, and Cam just said yes, because that's what Cam does in terms of advancing this conversation for reparations. So I'm super excited to get into this. I only have 30 minutes, right, okay, for a first conversation, then we'll open up for Q&A. So Cam, my first question, so NCOBRA, National Coalition of Blacks for Reparations in America, is the premier mass-based coalition of organizations and individuals organized for the sole purpose of advancing and obtaining reparations for descendants of African descent in the United States. At the founding meeting in 1987, it was convened for the purpose of broadening the base of support for the longstanding reparations movement. Mm-hmm. So, Cam, it's not 1987 anymore. We're way past that. But what do you make of the fact that 30 years onward, we're still in this fight for reparations, for redress from the transatlantic slave trade? What do you make of that?
Well, what we're really fighting against or struggling against is this whole notion of white supremacy and white nationalism, which is, you know, 400 plus years in the making. And so the reparations struggle or fight is just part and parcel of trying to overturn this whole system of anti-blackness. It took us 246 years to get out of enslavement. A lot of lives was lost, a lot of martyrs, a lot of, you know, dreams and hopes around, you know, this would be the last generation that had to face this. But it took, you know, multiple generations for us to get out of that. Coming out of enslavement, it took us 86 years to get out of apartheid in this country called Jim Crow segregation. Again, a lot of martyrs, a lot of people died, gave their life to ending that particular struggle, that particular aspect of criminality against black life and black humanity. It took a civil rights movement, it took a black power movement to end apartheid. So 30 years, putting in perspective, is not, you know, a long amount of time fighting against injustice in this country. And where we're at now, we're at an unprecedented stage in this fight. You know, it took us 30 years to get here. But right now we have, if you look at polls, over 87% of blacks now favor reparations for apartheid-like crimes and injuries. 78% favor reparations for enslavement-era injuries. 60% of millennials of all races favor reparations right now. That's unheard of. We have tremendous amount of white support. We have over 220 federal legislators who've signed on and co-sponsored legislation, whether it's H.R. 40, S. 40. So, you know, putting everything in perspective, 30 years took us to get to this point. You know, it took 15 years to get a holiday, some satisfaction for Martin Luther King, another 30 years before we got our second holiday at Juneteenth. So all of this effort that has been undergone by a lot of people, a lot of organizations, not just in Cobra, this is a movement, and the movement is many organizations, many individuals, scholars, you know, attorneys, legislators, all have added to where we are today. So I'm excited about this 30th year of being in this struggle. I'm very excited where we are today. Mm,
thank you. And, you know, the next question I want to ask, I want you to help us understand a little bit of the just the history of the movement of reparations and its connection to a more global movement. But first, a little bit of a history lesson for folks in the audience. So, you know, Massachusetts was the first colony to legalize slavery, right? So we were a place of many firsts. We were, yes, amongst the first to outlaw it. And in 1783, we actually had the first recorded case of reparations, right, for Belinda. And my team knows I'm always pulling out books. So if you don't know Belinda's petition as a part of your U.S. and Massachusetts history, you need to know this history because we had the first recorded case here of reparations for so many years of her life stolen, but she received a pension. And of course, the call for reparations has always been there, right? It's not like we went into slavery willingly, right? There was always resistance and always a call to redress. But help us understand a little bit more about this movement here in the US, but also connected globally, right? So there's a conversation with the reparations movement that this is only for US. But of course we know, and Yemisi, we were disconnected, right? But we're cousins. So help us understand the connection to our movement here and then this more global movement and this call for reparative justice.
Sure, the reparations movement is as old as, you know, Africans being snatched from the continent. In fact, if you look at reparations from the context of repair, the first thing we tried to repair was our freedom. And we did so on ships. Before we even got here, we did so rebelling on ships. We, you know, some people took that to the extreme and jumping overboard. You know, they weren't going into captivity somewhere else. When we got here, the first 20 or so blacks who were landed in Jamestown, we know that half of them escaped into the interior. 2, 3 years, 4 years later, they were not even recognized in the records. And so the first act of reparations was to repair our freedom, repair our human dignity. And so when we talk about the form of reparations movement, and then throughout enslavement, you had so many rebellions. I think one author recorded 250 slave rebellions. That's a part of attempting to repair our sovereignty as a people. We came, as my sister talked about, losing our culture. We came as ethnic groups, as sovereign individuals, part of sovereign nations. And we were trying to repair that. And part of the rebellions, we went out and we formed maroon communities into the swamps. You know, a lot of communities grew up in the swamps in Florida. That's what was part of the repair. That's a part of the spirit that I hold, that same spirit of attempting to erect a sovereign, independent reality for myself and my children, which is part of the repair. But the formal reparations movement, as we call it, probably began as special field orders, number 15, mm-hmm. After enslavement, after the emancipation, rather. They were still fighting. The Union Army had liberated the area in Savannah, Georgia. And when they liberated that area, the President Lincoln had already given an order stating that you had until January the 1st, 1865, to lay down your weapons. If you didn't, we were going to, you know, confiscate your property. And when January 1st came around and that land, you know, the Confederate soldiers were still fighting, he ordered his general and Secretary of War to go into Savannah, Georgia, speak to blacks who were there. He spoke to about 20 black clergy. And from that conversation came Special Field Order number 15, which guaranteed land of 40 acres. As you know, that was rescinded. So that started the first formal act of repair in this country. And then in the 1890s, you had the growth of the ex-slave mutual pension and bounty association started by Callie House, where it was her attempt to get pensions for ex-slaves whose productive life had passed. They were in their 60s, in their 70s. They couldn't produce, they couldn't pick cotton. And their children had been sold away. They didn't have any children to take care of them in old age. Mm-hmm. They, you know, as you would expect, when your productive life is over, you know, you would go and be around your children, you know, and your children would absorb you into their family, is what you would expect. But because of the theft of our children and the selling of our children, there was no ability to fall back on the progeny to assist them. So the sister organized over 300,000 members, dues-paying members, into this association, and they petitioned the government to redress those elders in the form of a pension. That the whole pension around Union soldiers was happening in the country, and so they felt that those pensions should also come to quote-unquote ex-slaves. That did not materialize, and so, you know, our sister was arrested for quote-unquote defrauding black people, having them believe that this government was going to redress them, and it wasn't, so she was sentenced to a year in jail. She came out. And then the movement went into the 1920s with the Universal Negro Improvement Association started by the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey. That was more for reparations in the form of repatriation. This country, there were many Africans who wanted to go back, African descendants who wanted to go back to the continent, the land of their mother and father's birth, foremothers and forefathers' birth, and that this country should supply them with resources. After, the same thing that Callie House was arrested on, Marcus Garvey was arrested on 30 years later, yeah. or 20 years later. Yeah. And but subsequently, that movement failed. Fast forward to 1951, William Patterson and Paul Robeson submitted a petition to the United Nations charging this country with genocide, and had over a million signatures in that petition. And then we moved into the late 50s, early 60s, when the Black Power movement, those who were focusing on black power, black independence, the Nation of Islam, the Republic of New Africa, the Black Panther Party, all had reparations in their platform, but it wasn't until 1987 when the COBA was formed, when you had one organization that was attempted to build a coalition solely on this issue of reparations and did tremendous work in the 90s, trying what we said was to bring make reparations a household word, because most people didn't know about reparations. And so we did a tremendous amount of work. And that led up into what I think was a pivotal moment in the reparations movement. And that was the World Conference Against Racism that was held in 2001 in Durban, South Africa. There had been two previous World Conference Against Racism before that time, the last one being in 1978. So this is really the third World Conference. And it was centered around people of African descent going to this conference when we wanted three outcomes. And these three outcomes was one, that the global community declared that reparations was a crime against humanity and that it always should have been. And there's a whole lot of international law around crimes against humanity and how those crimes should be redressed. The second thing we wanted to do at that conference was to indicate that as a result of those crimes, the current lived conditions of people of African descent are on the bottom in every human rights index, and every index, global index, and how you measure the quality of life, you'll find that the people and countries that were subjected to those crimes are at the bottom. So there's a legacy, a lived legacy today of the people, global, you know, over a billion people on this planet that are affected by those crimes today. And then third, that if those crimes were committed and you have injuries today, then the obligation now is to redress those injuries and repair those injuries. So from that, we have our brothers and sisters on the continent of Africa, because colonialism was also declared a crime against humanity. From that, our brothers and sisters in Europe, we saw with the Ukrainian war, we got brothers and sisters in Ukraine and Russia. You know, most people, a lot of people didn't know that, but our brothers and sisters all over Europe, our brothers and sisters in South America, where the largest group of blacks outside of Africa is in Brazil, over 100 million. You know, it's 48, 50 million blacks in America, but the largest group of blacks outside the continent of Africa in one nation is in South America. Our brothers and sisters in the Caribbean, and certainly those of us in North America, whether it's United States, Canada, or Mexico, we are all operating under the Durban paradigm. Crimes were committed, injuries have resulted, and therefore repair is obligatory by whatever nation you live in. And so that's what a global movement is, and we're excited to be having this united conversation around the world of African people and people of African descent. So this is very exciting. I don't know if you can hear the excitement in my voice, but this is a very exciting time to be African, to be black, and to be fighting for justice on this planet.
Mm, amen. Can you just raise your hand if you just learned something? I mean, I think, right? Cam, I just wanna take you with me, because this part of what we've been talking about this whole week is the power of ideas and truth telling. Right? So there is history that needs to be known. We all need to be able to tell that history in the same way I talk about my family. Because this is my family, right? This is what we're talking about, repairing the human family, our human condition, right? So just a thank you for that history lesson. And, you know, as you speak, it's clear, right, what has happened and what is necessary. But talk to us a little bit more about, you know, what's the role, you think, of government in this repair conversation, right? So here's my other book, y'all. This is the other thing you need to study that Cam wrote. It's called Laying the Foundation for Local Reparations, right? So you make this beautiful case between the federal and the local work, and later we're gonna have a panel of our local leaders. But what's the role of government, both at the federal and local level, around repair and redress?
So the role of government is that they should own the crimes that they have committed against black people. You know, these governments establish the laws to orchestrate this global or this whether it's a nation or the state, this global process of stealing the labor of African people. I look at three bases in which we can champion or make our demand for reparations on a federal, state, or local level, and that is the basis of genocide, the basis of plunder, and the basis of apartheid. All three of these are crimes against humanity under international law. So governments the federal government, was engaged in the genocide of African people, the murder of African people in part or in whole, creating conditions that cause bodily harm, psychological and mental harm, trauma, et cetera. So the government has a responsibility because that was a crime that they, were part and partial of erecting laws and things to support, as well as receiving taxes and all type of benefit and revenue from that. States are also responsible because, when you look at states like Alabama, states in the South, after enslavement, after Reconstruction, they instituted policy that we know as slavery by another name, convict leasing, et cetera. In Alabama, 80% of the state's revenue budget came from convict leasing after enslavement. You imagine the budget of Massachusetts, and 80% comes from one source, and that source is from crimes against a particular people. That is what was happening out after enslavement. And in certainly cities, I live in the city, Chicago, a large metropolitan city, and we know the apartheid that exists in Chicago. Apartheid means separate development, based on race, backed by the force of the government. And so when you look at all the different the disparities between black Chicagoans or black Bostonians and Bostonians and white Bostonians, the disparities in health, disparity in education, disparity in how we're treated by the police, that's apartheid, that's neo-apartheid. And those are laws that are put in place at the municipal level. We can go back and we can trace, how the educational system was funded or not funded in areas where black children are taught. And these are municipal policies. And so, plunder, we know how black communities were, business communities around the country were destroyed because as they were building the highway system or urban development or gentrification. So, in 2007 through 2012, $300 billion of black wealth was stolen from us. 60% of the black wealth in this country from the housing crisis. In a city like Chicago, $4 billion of that $300 billion stolen from the community. This is like mega dollars, And so we can see cities, states, federal government all have a culpability in what I spoke to earlier, the legacy of how we experience life in this country, in these states, and in these cities. So they're culpable parties, and so each has a responsibility under international law, an obligatory responsibility to engage in repair and redress. Right.
And I know as we're sitting here, there's a whole action in D.C. calling on President Biden to pass H.R. 40 by executive order, right now. Cam, maybe talk a little bit, and about 10 minutes, I'll open up for questions from the audience, and this question may come up too. The case seems clear, right? The case seems clear, and yet we're still right here. What all do we need to be doing together, right? How do we, it feels like, and you talked about, right, we're up against centuries of white supremacy culture, and we're up against so much where facts and then the history are not enough. But tell us, what else do we need to be doing? What needs to be done together?
Well, education is the first component. We all must be educated, crimes, injury, repair, what we call it, reparations 1, 2, 3. And in each city, every city, every community must uncover the harms or crimes committed against the black population in that city. We know we're fastly gathering the data around the national picture of black life in this country and how it got here. But on the city level, you know, we need to be more specific on how the harm has impacted the lives of us in our local areas. The data has to drive everything, you know, understanding, you know, the level of disparity and how that disparity happened. And then, you know, having courageous legislators and policymakers is key. Most legislators in this country do not get elected by the resources of their constituency, right? They get elected by the resources of these powerful institutions, businesses, et cetera. And it is these powerful businesses and institutions that have a history of the anti-blackness. And so in order to sometimes be elected, you have to lead away from this issue of reparations. You can't embrace it. So you have to have courageous elected officials. And we have to also, that goes to that, we have to begin funding our politicians as well. And then stand behind them when they stand up, because they're fighting part of this, you know, 400-year battle, you know, 30 years within COBRA, 400 years. They're fighting also part of this. So, you know, that's, you know, we have to understand how we've been harmed at every level, federal, state, and local. We have to use the data to show the disparities, and we have to to be able to document the disparities, craft policies to address those disparities, and get, you know, some courageous legislators to create policy to direct resources toward the injuries that we suffer.
And then be willing to stand with them.
And be willing to stand with them. That's the other part of that.
Yeah.
Is be willing to stand with them.
Yeah. I want to give you a chance to talk a little bit about the report that came out last year, The Harm Is in Our Genes, and the epigenetics of the legacy of you know, this brutal system of slavery. So maybe talk a little about that, and then we'll open up for some questions.
Sure. About in 2014, I think it was, a brother in Chicago, a physician, medical physician, contacted with me and shared with me some of his research that he was doing around transgenerational epigenetic inheritance. And that's like a mouthful. But transgenerational means just something that passes down multiple generations, generally past three generations. You'll use multi-generations if it's passed down like from grandparent to parent to child. But transgenerational means more than those three generations. Epigenetics is a science around how the environment affects the genes. So transgenerational epigenetics is how the environment affects the genes that's passed down multiple generations. And so this new science, you know, he was showing me around how third generation Jewish Holocaust survivors, their grandchildren, had higher rates of medical illnesses than their peers whose grandparents did not go through the Holocaust. And they were able to determine that that trauma of the Holocaust passed down genetically. It affects the epigenome. Epigenome tells the gene to turn on and turn off. Doesn't affect the gene, but it tells the gene how to respond to the environment. So if you're in a stressful situation, something would tell your gene to cut on, and then when that stressful situation is gone, it'll tell it to turn off. But when your gene has been affected by trauma, it doesn't do that when it's supposed to do. It might stay on even though you're not threatened, and that could have a deleterious effect on your health. And so our Jewish brothers and sisters, you know, went through a 6-year period, probably 10 or 15 years of atrocities before the actual Holocaust. So let's say 20 years, but we've gone through 400 years of uninterrupted trauma. And so this whole study around transgenerational epigenetic inheritance says that the reason we have this tremendously poor health profile in this country is a result of the trauma, and now we have the science of transgenerational epigenetic inheritance to prove it. We can prove that under the microscope, our epigenome is supposed to wrap around proteins is unraveled, right? We can prove that the telomeres, which is a part of the end cap of the gene, is shortened, as opposed to if we didn't go through this. And that these effects on our genes and effects on our telomeres, on apogen on our telomeres, leads to premature deaths, a weakened immune system, an immune system that turns against itself, a susceptibility to all type of diseases, shortened lifespan. All of these things we know as a science now that we didn't know. So when Mitch McConnell or someone else says, this happened so long ago, none of you were alive who were affected by enslavement. Yeah, I'm alive. I've been affected by enslavement. It's in my genes. I can tell you. I can show you. Let's get a microscope. My children are affected. My grandchildren are affected. But we do know with this science that it can be remediated. But we need resources. We need to educate our people about this, educate the country about it, get resources into public health spaces so we can share this knowledge and we can do the things that we know can remediate it. That's part of the repair. The life expectancy between black and white in this country is, you know, over 10 years. Some instances like Chicago between white men and black men, it's a 30-year life expectancy difference. And it's a result of the historical trauma that we've experienced and that we're still experiencing with police terror and all these so-called microaggressions. Those microaggressions add up.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So, yeah.
So I'm gonna open up in about 2 minutes so y'all get your questions ready. But Cam, we're a multiracial audience here. This is the Embrace Ideas Festival. Why is it important for all of us to embrace reparations? And why does that matter? Why do we all have to take
America
it up?
America is sick. I mean, America, all of America is sick. Psychologically, culturally, you know, when you can sit around and watch the suffering of people and do nothing, that's a sickness. You know, your human nature says help. You know, you see someone suffering. And so, but we see it getting better. We have tremendous amount of our allies, you know, whites who are helping us, who are seeing this, the data, the videos that are being shown, you know, of the type of harms that are happening to people of African descent. They're seeing that, and they're being touched, and they're being moved by it. They're becoming active, and that's great. So it heals all of America, even on the economic level. Yeah. You know, there's a Citigroup study that shows that, you know, America, you know, the GDP would increase 0.4 of a point of a percentage every year. Hundreds of millions of jobs would be produced annually by reparations to black people. The business revenue of the country would be increased in the trillions by reparations to black people. The entire country benefits economically. The entire country benefits culturally. The entire country benefits morally by doing the right thing to black people. It'll be the greatest benefit to this country since its start. You know, I mean, that's how I see it.
Yeah, thank you. Cam, I'm so glad we're recording this so we can just send it out and just keep repeating this. So thank you. All right, I think I'm going to pull up the lights and get some questions. All right, Reverend Brown.
Cam, thank you for being here and coming here. I just wanted to do one clarifying question so that people would know, and then the next one is a little complex question. The first one is, can you explain what H.R. 40 is so that people will be educated as to what that is and, you know, your opinion about whether or not it'll be passed, and if it'll be passed, would it make a difference? And then the second piece, it's a more of a conceptual question because I'm aware of what Evanston, Illinois has done and the specifics of it being a housing program and $25,000 that would go to those families who can find their origins in Evanston and you know, for housing. And for me, the amount that is due black people is enormous. And I understand the motivation that we have to start somewhere, but my fear is that if we start too small, then what we will end up having it would be also too small. So first one on H.R. 40, the next one on the other one.
Excuse me. Thank you for both of those questions. So H.R. 40 is the only federal bill introduced in this country since to deal with this issue of redress since the Reconstruction, right after enslavement. So we're talking over 160 plus years, probably 130 years at the time it was introduced. There hadn't been any federal legislation. So this is the only federal legislation, and it's designed not to offer reparations, but to study the, now it's to study the range of crimes committed and the range of injuries that we suffer from as a result of those crimes over 400 years, and then offer concrete proposals to address those injuries that we have defined. You know, what programs, policies, and practices must be put in place, how much resources have to be attached to each of those policies, programs, and practices in order to get us from a state of massive injury to a state of repair. And repair, going to your second part of your question, the repair to get to that state of repair or parity is gonna take generations. Because this didn't happen to us in one generation. This happened to us multiple generations. And some of our problems are so deep that it's gonna take a tremendous amount of targeted resources, not just financial, but human resources, will to address. And so we can't start small. And that's why we wrote in H.R. 40 the international model around reparations. And that's, you know, full reparations have five components. First, cessation and guarantees of non-repetition. What policies are in place right now that still disproportionately negatively affect Black people on the federal, state, and local levels? We have to identify those policies, and we have to put a halt to them. And then we have to put in structures to make sure that those same type of adversely affecting policies do not resurface in another name the way slavery did. That's the first component. And that's gonna take a tremendous amount of effort to do that, and creativity. The second component is restitution, and that's the things like education and business development and health and housing and all those type of things that are necessary. It's gonna take us multiple generations just to get on parity with the graduation rates of we're not gonna even say white America, let's look at Asians, because they got the highest rates of graduation. We wanna be, you know, we wanna increase. We don't set our bar, you know, below what it can be. It's gonna take multiple generations to get us to the housing standard that we should be at. So, you know, in the area of restitution, tremendous amount of resources have to be targeted. And then there's satisfaction. Satisfaction is, you know, how do you turn your dignity back to people? You know, these apologies and monuments and museums and, you know, institutions have to be funded across the country generationally. Compensation, you know, there's a study just came out that's saying the compensation is a viable part of reparations. That's a check to every individual. However, the report stated that there's some things that had to be in place for that to be meaningful, or you'll find that the wealth gap will be wider later, mm-hmm. even after compensating mm-hmm. us. And so those type of things, that's multi-generational right. as well. So every aspect of the repair that we're talking about that we need, it's not no quick fix. It's never gonna be a quick fix. Someone's selling you a quick fix, they are doing this, they're selling you a false idea. This is a multi-generational effort of justice. Yeah. And it's the largest, it's the transatlantic slave trade, it's the largest crime in human history. Yeah. The largest crime in human history. And so the redress has to be the largest effort of justice in human history.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
So thank you for that question.
Yeah, thank you. And Reverend Brown, we have the architect of the Evanston, Illinois model coming on the panel next. And we can talk, a courageous elected official right here at the front that Cam was talking about. All right, go ahead. And I see others are lining up.
Good afternoon. My name is Hakeem Cunningham. I'm from Fairmount Innovation Lab. And I wanted to ask probably two questions relevant to the reparations conversation is one, I am the offspring of a Jamaican immigrant father who was undocumented, and also have a mother who is from the Florida Maroon faction in Leesburg and also Orlando, Florida, who actually, you know, they were married. So I feel like I have a dual identity in the fight sometimes because I'm like, oh, my father's from Jamaica, so I'm only going to get 50%, right? Well, my mother's from Maroon, so, you know, she fights for a different cause coming up from the South into her identity as a Maroon, you know, coming from a Maroon family. So I tend to try to look at the situation and say, am I whole in this fight or am I partial in this fight? Mm. And what does that mean for me in relation to reparations? Mm.
Great question.
So that's a raging debate at this moment.
Yeah, it's an internal debate with me I've been having for a very long time.
So, brother, if I could just wipe away that internal battle with you, my position is all black people harmed in America by America should be repaired in America by America. And so that would wipe away the debate. But everybody doesn't see it like that, unfortunately. There were three periods of crimes, the crime of enslavement, the crime of apartheid, and the post-apartheid, what I call the neo-apartheid era that we're in now. And so people came into this country, black people came into this country forcefully during a period of enslavement, some voluntarily, some forcefully after enslavement ended, and certainly, you know, in this, after Reconstruction, most blacks who came into this country came in voluntarily. But all blacks that came in this country, no matter when we got here, we still experienced anti-blackness that shows itself up in some type of discriminatory, harmful way, injurious way. And so when we talk about repairing the educational system, when we talk about repairing all these systems, we talk about repairing the policies, you know, by talking about cessation and guarantees and non-repetition, that would affect us all. So we all would benefit from that form of from those forms of repair. When it comes to compensation, that's a whole nother story. What are you trying to compensate? For instance, and Robin can talk more about it, their program is a compensatory program of $25,000 housing grant, but they're not trying to compensate enslavement. Right. So, you know, that wouldn't go just to descendants of Africans enslaved here. It will go to some of them, but the period they're compensating is the period during redlining for that particular injury. So any black person who is in that particular area at that particular time can make a claim for redress. So it's a complicated issue, but the simple answer is all black people harmed in America by America should be repaired in America by America.
That's right. And I think, Cam, just to underscore something that we didn't explicitly say, reparations is a process, right? It's not a one-time thing. And as you just said, it's going to have to be multi-generational, has to be the biggest thing. So of course, it's going to have many components to it. And what I've learned so much from you is that connection from the national to the local, each local municipality has to figure out what their what's the repair for, and to define it as such. So I hope that, I don't see Hakeem where you are, but hope that allayed any kind of feeling of This country already rips us apart in terms of identity, and so we don't need in this movement to do that to each other. I feel like I've definitely learned that from you. So I think I have time for maybe at least two more questions. Yeah, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Connie Holmes, and I'm representing the Reparations Community of Practice, which is affiliated with the Episcopal Diocese of Massachusetts.
Great, thank you.
Great, thank you.
And my mother fled Vienna, and received reparations for 30 years from the Austrian government, which mounted a referendum to the populace, taking responsibility for the atrocities that they perpetrated. But it took 50 years, and as you point out, the history of slavery in this country is 400 years. So I'm aware of the differences in the situation, but the moral principle is the same.
Sure.
So the Reparations Community of Practice invited Kirsten Mullen and William Darity from the University of North Carolina to present to us last January about their scholarship in the book that they created, From Here to Equality, and the plan that they are promulgating for how to actually make reparations happen in this country on the federal level, right? For the federal government taking responsibility as the primary perpetrator, just as the Austrian government was the primary perpetrator against Jews in there. So I'm interested in hearing what your opinion is of the work of Drs. Mullen and Darity. They have asked us to consider a $14 trillion plan over 10 years, $1.4 trillion over 10 years. So I'm very interested in your comments on their work and whether or not what it is that they're promoting is something that we can hope for in the future. Thank you.
Whether or not we can hope for it, let me get to that. we certainly thank Dr. Darity and Dr. Mullins for their work and voice and scholarship in this movement, especially around economics. We have some points that we disagree on, and we have some points that we agree upon. We don't believe that only the primary culprit should be held responsible. The primary, the secondary, the tertiary, all the way down the line, they should be held responsible, as well as corporations, as well as institutions. There's a whole range of criminal entities in this government, in this space called America, that all have to be held accountable for the injurious legacy that is lived in the lives of 50 million people of African descent in this country. They all have to be held responsible. So we take a both and view of that. Dr. Darity and Dr. Mullins just take a singular focus. So we disagree, but we still have the same primary entity that we both petition and fight to have resources targeted. Dr. Darity's program is couched in the term ARC, apology, restitution, closure. With the conversation with a reverend earlier, there cannot be any closure after you pay $14 trillion if the injury still remains, right? And I certainly like the price tag of $14 trillion. I'm not going to, fight against that. But do I have hope that that's going to be implemented? I don't think so in that form. Mm. I think $14 trillion, $30 trillion over generations may be more doable than $14 trillion in 10 years. So I'm not sure how viable that particular plan is. But I thank him for putting forth the plan because, it forces the powers that be to look at the type of monetary commitment they're going to have to make at some point and for some duration. Will it be 10 years or will it be, four or five generations? There's going to have to be a huge contribution of resources to address this issue. But again, the early data shows that it would not be just an outlay, it would be an investment because you would get returns back. So, and I think that's more of how we're pushing it.
Yeah, thank you. Is there any last questions? Tisha. Clap it up for Tisha, my colleague at King Boston. She did a lot of prep behind this panel as well.
Hey, Cam, it's great to have you in Boston. I had a pretty simple question. Do you feel like full repair is possible without an outside stakeholder to hold us accountable as a country? Looking to like Germany and other models of repair globally.
I don't think any outside entity can hold America accountable, just politically, because of, the sovereignty of nations. However, we have always looked at the international component of the struggle, utilizing international law, as I talked about. You know, the Durban World Conference Against Racism was a huge international event that brought pressure and a lens on repair to all nations on the planet who are part of that structure. The pressure from internationalizing our movement is that this country cannot go to any other country and say, look at your human rights violations, right? Without looking at own. This country say, right? No, you look at your human rights violations. You look what you're doing to the African people. And that's what has been happening. That's what has happened, and that's what's continuing to happen. Yeah. You know, there's a pointing of fingers on human rights violations between China and the United States. It's not publicized much, but I can tell you it's happening. That China's pointing at America, America's pointing at China, and China always raises what America's doing to the black population in this country. And so that's the type of international pressure that we can attempt to get influence from, but also try to increase it so that this country has to deal with it as it deals with its international relationships around the world. Thank you for that question.
Yeah, thank you, Tisha. And with that, y'all, let's clap it up for Cam. Thank you. And just again, a big welcome to Boston. We hope we do you proud as a city. I mean, we're trying to change things here, right? That's the whole point of things like this. So thank you all. And I think, Yemisi, we're going for a break.
Yes.
Welcome back, everyone. I am so excited for this next discussion that will talk about how other cities are tackling local reparations. My colleague, Saraya Wintersmith, will moderate this panel, and I had an opportunity to chat with her prior, and she's gonna be stellar as well as this panel. Saraya covers Boston City Hall for GBH News. Before that, she covered the Dorchester, Roxbury, Mattapan neighborhoods, focusing on how people live and the issues that shaped those communities. Prior to joining GBH News, Saraya worked as a state house reporter, producing radio and television stories for WCVE and now VPM in Richmond, Virginia. Saraya lives in Dorchester and holds a journalism degree from Howard University. She has covered issues related to reparations for GBH News program Talking Politics. So it is my privilege and honor to introduce to you your moderator, Saraya.
You know I love music. And every time I hear something hot, it makes me want to move. It makes me want to have fun. But it's something about this joint right here. This joint right here, it makes me want to.
Did you give a walk-up song?
Break.
Did you do a walk-up?
Can y'all hear me? Yes? Excellent. Thank you so much to King Boston for allowing us to dive really deeply into a conversation. I was just saying outside, as a journalist, when you're covering daily news, you don't get to delve into a topic as much as you want. But today we have the space to explore the topic of reparations a little bit more deeply. I'm going to introduce you to our wonderful panelists, starting with Dr. Jemadari Kamara. He's an associate professor of Africana Studies in the College of Liberal Arts at the University of Massachusetts, Boston, as well as a director of the Center for African, Caribbean, and Community Development. He's a leading researcher and scholar in local, national, and global reparations movements. His areas of expertise include African American urban politics, African American intellectual thought, and he's received his PhD from the University of Michigan. Welcome, Dr. Kamara. You may. I haven't seen you since the Talking Politics episode. Our next panelist is Cheryl Evans Davis. She's the executive director of the San Francisco Human Rights Commission. For nearly three decades, Davis has made contributions as an educator and leader with expertise in community outreach and engagement, workforce development, youth development, and violence prevention. Davis has coordinated the allocation of $120 million to support the Black community in San Francisco and staffs the San Francisco African American Reparations Advisory Committee. Davis holds a BA from San Francisco State, an MPA from the University of San Francisco, and recently completed a Doctor of Education at the University of Southern California's Rossier School of Education. Welcome, Cheryl Evans Davis. And last but not least, we have Robin Rue Simmons, the founder and executive director of First Repair, a nonprofit organization that informs local reparations nationally. She's the former 5th Ward Alderman for the city of Evanston, that's what we were talking about, courageous political leaders, where she led the passage of the nation's first municipal-funded reparations legislation. She laid the foundation for her life's work in 1998 when she became a real estate broker. Troubled by wealth disparities and concentrated poverty she witnessed locally, she wanted to help families build wealth through homeownership. Rue Simmons has received numerous awards and has been featured in national and international publications for her public service work. Welcome, Robin Rue Simmons. Uh-oh. Hey. Excellent. So thank you for all of you joining us here at the Embrace Ideas Festival. I want to start with a question for everybody to answer. NCOBRA has defined reparations as the process of repairing, healing, and restoring a people who were injured due to their group identity in violation of their fundamental human rights by a government, corporation, institution, or individual. Talk to us a little bit about how each of your communities has begun this process and what specific rehabilitation tools and resources are being implemented to support Black residents impacted by the legacies of slavery and Jim Crow. You're immediately next to me. You are also the Baba on the stage, so you start.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for the question, Saraya, and the opportunity that King Boston has provided for us to address this question here in the city. I think, as most of you are aware, there have been several recent initiatives in the city of Boston focusing on a resolution that would call for a public apology from the public sector, as well as the motion at the level of the city council to establish a commission to study the question of reparations. This is a foundation here and a set of public sector initiatives that have been built on legislation in the public domain, initially filed in 1988 by the late Senator Bill Owens, who filed the first such legislation that became the foundation of H.R. 40. It was never heard in the state legislature here in the Commonwealth, but because of his relationship with Congressman Conyers and the work that went on following that, we have a foundation on which we are building those initiatives here in Boston. Certainly, that is the work focused on the public domain. I was particularly pleased to hear our conversation begin to address questions of how do we engage this very broad, complex issue in other sectors of our community, particularly at the domain of the church and at the core of our economic foundation here in Boston, which is higher education, with over 60 institutions of higher education in the city, in greater metropolitan area. The recent Harvard study, which has begun to focus on the question of a legacy fund, I think the number is about 100 million that they're beginning to look at. Not quite clear yet on the relationship that has to the nearly 50 billion endowment, but it's a discussion we can have. And as well as the issue of the church and the legacy of the church and other nonprofit sectors, but particularly here in Massachusetts, the young lady who addressed the question of the Episcopal Church, Unitarian Church, which is based in Boston, has a long legacy extending back to the Black Manifesto. I think Cam referenced that in the 60s, which challenged the institution of the church to $500 million at that time. Sounded like a lot of money. But, inflation is, right? It's killing us, right? So I think there are a number of these areas that in which we are working and that we continue to want to push forward from and learn from the experiences of others as well.
Cheryl Evans Davis, I know in California, your state just decided on the lineage standard, but talk about how your work in San Francisco has gone.
Yeah, thank you. So in San Francisco, our president of the Board of Supervisors introduced a resolution and then legislation to create our reparations advisory task force. And that 15-member body was selected and went through this process. They get paid to participate. They meet monthly. But beyond that, the focus has really been on, in a space like San Francisco, in the state of California, people easily say, well, it wasn't a slave state. We shouldn't have this conversation. So there's a whole lot of education that has to happen as well. We have, fortunately, a parallel activity happening at the same time. One is the actual, like, how do we document, how do we talk about the harm to Black folks in San Francisco? The disparities that we see across the nation, whether it's, less than 6% of the population is Black, but more than 50% of the folks incarcerated are, less than 7% of the school district population is Black, but more than 30% of expulsions and suspensions are, right? So these numbers are still the same, even though it's a small population. So being able to say there's nothing wrong with the people, there's something wrong with the system, and really being able to make that case is a lot of what we're doing at this point in time. And the parallel activity is that a couple years ago, the mayor and the president of the Board of Supervisors allocated $60 million a year specifically for Black folks, right? To talk about, like, how do we begin to have the conversation about, as the folks in my office say, visibilizing, right? Like, making sure that we see Black folks and not just as people who live in public housing or people who are incarcerated, but as humans, as people in the city that are valued and celebrated and recognized. So we've been doing this process both through the reparations advisory group, the task force, but also with the community at large to talk about what does an investment look like, right? Because there's a lot of debate over, is this about cash money directly to people, or is this about making sure that the quality of life and the access to education and the ability to own a home or the ability to, like, celebrate your culture and not be ashamed to do that? Those are the things that we're in the process of doing, and I think the challenge is folks say, like, why do we need to do this, right? Why is this important? And that's the narrative shift. So we've invested quite a bit of money into what we call narrative shift storytelling, which is the ability for folks to tell their story, to celebrate their history, and to change how folks are seen, so that I get away from talking about the statistics of who's incarcerated and focus instead not on deficit-based but the asset-based models about what it is, the contributions that folks have made despite the harm, and to really talk about what else could have been done. We look at gentrification, and I think we've learned a lot from Evanston. You know, we had, during redevelopment era, 10,000 people were displaced from their homes. And so in San Francisco and in the state of California, we have Prop 209, which says we're not supposed to talk about race, right? Like, race cannot be a factor in how you make decisions in terms of if you're giving out money. Well, with these 10,000 people that were displaced, 90% of them were Black. So if we say certificate holders, right, if we do it around housing and we say certificate holders, of which The problem is 10,000 people that were displaced 60 years ago, right? So then it becomes, well, do you pass that down to the family? And how far down does it go? So a lot of what we're doing is both the actual money out the door, $60 million that we're doing through what we call the Dream Keeper Initiative, the work that we're doing with the task force, but the other is around these policies, right, that said this can only go to the person who was living in the household at the time of displacement. Well, if grandma was already 70 at the time of displacement 60 years ago, chances are grandma's not going to be able to use that certificate 60 years later. So what are we doing to make sure that her children, her grandchildren, anyone that was in the house, whether they were her children or not, are able to access that? So we're doing policy work, we're doing the reparations development work, but then we're also really looking at, as we've moved this money out the door, what has been the benefit, and redefining, this is, I would say, the hardest part, redefining success, mm-hmm. right? And I appreciate the conversation earlier about it's not gonna happen, you know, like don't think because you gave somebody $60 million in November that January that the achievement gap is going to be closed and that everyone's gonna own a home. You know, houses in San Francisco are $1.5 million. Mm-hmm. So maybe 40 people could get, you know, if you were buying a home with them, maybe 40 people could get a house at $60 million. So we really are having to redefine success. Success may not look like every black student now is an A student. It may look differently, and we need to just have the conversation about success might just mean I feel welcome in this room today.
Mm. There's so much, just between these two, so much to come back to. Robin Rue Simmons, I know you've moved on to founding your own efforts, but talk a little bit about your work in Evanston.
Absolutely, and I have been appointed to continue my works with the city of Evanston. I'm appointed to continue on the reparations committee. But our steps in reparations really started in 2002. Cam mentioned the World Conference Against Racism, that historic conference in Durban, and at the time, council member Lionel Jean-Baptiste, a mentor of mine, now Judge Lionel Jean-Baptiste, he returned home and led our city in the passing of a reparations resolution in 2002 that supported HR 40, supported slavery reparations. He was among what I understand to be dozens of other local leaders that made this commitment in their cities. And moving on, we see that HR 40 has not until very recently made much progress, and we're excited to see that it passed out of Judiciary Committee last year. But in my role as a local elected leader, I saw that there were local issues that were harmful, egregious crimes above and beyond what was happening at a federal level. And we implemented a reparation program in 2019. And that has taken a extensive public process where we were informed by stakeholders in Evanston, black folks in Evanston, participated in a community engagement process through 2019 that informed the outcomes of our legislation and informed how we would prioritize redress. And our legislation, 126R19, prioritizes housing, economic development, and educational initiatives, and that was established in 2019. And so moving forward, the committee and the community experts, including Cam Howard, who also is a board member at First Repair and a mentor of mine, NARC and COBRA, academics, a long list of experts have mentored Evanston through its process, and we have begun to implement our reparations program. So we have identified eligibility that is in direct correlation to the harm. Our eligibility as well as our remedy is in direct correlation to the harm. So in Evanston, we had anti-black housing laws and zoning laws that stripped away wealth and opportunity from the black community. And so we have identified that period of 1919 to 1969 as a period of harm in the black community. So everyone that lived there during that period of time and their direct descendants qualify for reparations. And so what I can say in this learning process over the last 3 years is a legal partner is probably the most important partner in this work. Identifying a viable legal framework that allows us to have a tangible, real program that we can implement and disperse. And so We have selected our initial eligible recipients. We have begun dispersing these benefits in January of this year, mm-hmm. and the outcomes that we're hearing are exactly what we were hoping for, that our recipients are feeling first heard, beginning to feel more of a sense of place, beginning to feel at least an effort to be made whole, and also acknowledging, as we acknowledge on the committee, that $25,000 is not nearly enough. Not nearly enough at a local level, but we also know that our local initiatives will never be enough, and that's why we stand on our demand for HR 40 to pass while we work on our local initiatives. But also knowing that it's not just the municipal government in Evanston. There are many institutional accomplices. So we are calling our healthcare systems, our public school districts, Northwestern University, industries, banks, family foundations, specific families in town to the reparations activity in Evanston.
It's a lot of expertise on this stage right now, y'all. Just bask in that for a moment. Dr. Kamara, I know from talking to you that you think about a global framing when we're talking about reparations. And it typically involves payment, which we've all established is crucial. But a lot of advocates for repair have placed emphasis on truth-telling and institutional change and cultural change as really important parts of reparations in the United States. Do you think that these components are executed enough when we're talking about reparations? And why do you think that they're an important springboard? I'm assuming that you're going to tell me no. Why are they important?
In the global context of discussing this question of reparations, internationally, there's been a process called Truth and Reconciliation Commissions that have been established in a series of countries around the world where there have been conflicts in order to alleviate the tensions and to try to mitigate the process. One of the, and this is from Argentina, Chile, South Africa, Malawi, I mean, a number of countries around the world. But one of the dynamics that has occurred in that process of coming from whatever form of truth telling that came forward to this issue of reconciliation is an understanding that there is a crossroads, there's a space in between, that you can't get to reconciliation even after truth is on the table until you deal with repair. And in many of these cases, the repair is what they were trying not to deal with, which is why they set up the commission. So if it is, if we have this understanding now, this learning from these experiences, how do we engage this question of repair? The repair, and I think Cam laid out very clearly earlier, we're not just talking about money. For the moment, let's take money off the table. What about the psychological, the social, the cultural issues of repair? The dynamic that we're speaking about that is in called the Ma'afa or the international slave trade or whatever you want to call that experience of several hundred years. And please forgive me if I, you know, get too intellectual and academic.
No, but
it's a dialectic. Okay, you want to talk? It's a dialectic. Let's talk. It's a dialectic. And it impacts both sides in this process. And it's therefore, Cam spoke about the human rights and development indexes. Doesn't matter whether it's educational, healthcare, globally. If you look at the UN indices, 3/4 of the world, and I haven't done it for this last couple of years, but 3/4 of the world who are at the bottom of the index, the Human Development Index, were either in Africa or led by people of African descent. Now, unless you believe in the biological inferiority of black people, there's got to be some other systemic or structural issue that has produced this global structure. And in so doing, it has produced a relationship so that there has been an internalization among us of our own inferiority, as well as an internalization of the sense of superiority of those who produce the system. Mm-hmm. And now are reproducing that system of superiority in their own interests. Mm-hmm. One of the, most recently you may have heard about the apology that has been requested here in the city through form of resolution.
Passed yesterday, yep. Yep.
A number of years ago in the city of Boston, and I'm glad you opened with your comments today, King Potozume Akpon III, the king of Porto Novo, in Boston, came and made a formal apology on behalf of the traditional African leadership to the communities of African descent here in Boston, in the diaspora, for the role that they played. Consciously or unconsciously, his understanding that they played a role in producing and reproducing the system that currently exists. Mm-hmm. We talked about Durban. Your comments are very interesting about Durban and earlier. Durban initiative in the global context that has produced these resolutions and so forth came from the NGO community. The US delegation in Durban, I gotta tell the truth, was on the advice of Dr. Condoleezza Rice, led out of the Durban conference by General Colin Powell. We, the United States, representing us, did not participate on our advice and our leadership. There are contradictions that have been produced by this relationship and reproduced as a dialectic that we've got to engage in. Mm-hmm. If we're going to confront this in order to really grapple with where we are in the 21st century, and therefore, that's why placing centrally this question straight up on the table of reparations, of repair, cultural, psychological, social, internal, as well as external, is so very critically important. Because it's not just about them. What about what's happened to us? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And how do we engage and bridge a conversation with each other? Mm-hmm. Which is particularly important for us here in Boston, because of who we are. You know, uniquely, I have so much appreciation for what's going on in San Francisco, but uniquely Boston represents the United States in 2040. We are, reflectively, in terms of our ethnicity, our economics, the structure of our economy being based on infotech driving this economy, who the United States will be like. In this microcosm, then, that is us now, can we begin to engage the structural question of how do we deal with the wealth gap? I think everyone's familiar with the distorted wealth gap here, $247,500, right?
You know,
and we got eight. Literally, for those who aren't from here, yeah, eight. Great. Can we actually deal with that in real terms and begin to grapple with that here, so that the notion that we are using here is that it is really a global struggle, because the global implications of this, whether it's on the Caribbean that initiated in 2014, the Caribbean Reparations Commission, now reproduced here by the National African American Reparations Commission, that has produced out of that relationship, their structural relationship dealing with the, Great Britain and the other power, France, Spain, For example, a 20 million pound relationship between the University of Edinburgh and the University of the West Indies, produced by the leader, Dr. Hilary Beckles, of the University of the West Indies, now being transferred from Edinburgh to the University of West Indies as a first step. 20 million pounds, by the way, happens to be the exact amount that was paid by Great Britain in 1830s to the slave owners. Can we structurally here in Boston grapple with that as a microcosm here in our community, dealing with the church, dealing with these educational institutions, many of whom had contributions, as we're finding out from the Harvard study or the Brown study, that money came from the plantation owners that they had in the plantations in Cuba or in the Caribbean. The culpability is linked. We can't disengage that. It's complex, I understand. Mm-hmm. Very complex.
You're indicting everybody, Dr. Kumar.
No. But I'm saying everyone has to participate in the resolution of the problem.
Yes, sir.
That's what I'm saying.
Yes, sir.
Because we all stand as beneficiaries. We all stand as beneficiaries of a system that is interlinked and is international. And we have to be then willing to work with others internationally to engage in that struggle, and we start right in our own community. Mm-hmm. Because the global is right here. We are it.
Cheryl Evans Davis, I want to make sure I give you a chance to talk because you were talking about storytelling and changing narratives. Talk a little bit about how truth telling plays out in your work.
Yeah, I'm like all the things. I'm like trying to write it all down quickly. I think the challenge around truth telling in so many ways is that, and that's why the psychological support and when we talk about reparation, because when you start to tell your truth, when you have to unpack all of that, when we open up those wounds, we're causing more harm, right? The reliving of the story is, it's healing, but it's also harmful. And if we don't have folks in place who understand that, right, who can help to unpack that, we've been having these conversations around, like, let's tell truth around even the lens in which we talk about therapy and healing and telling truth and the fear of telling the truth, because how far back do you go? I'll be in spaces sometimes and I'll talk about the look that my mother gave me that sometimes maybe was followed by a hand and be like, wait, is the statute of limitations on this, or is she going to be picked up for child abuse, right? Because there are some things in our history that we have used as part of our pathology in some way to say, this made me who I am, right? This is part of who I am and why I am able to overcome because, you know, of these challenges. And so the truth of remembering, I was riding actually yesterday with somebody and we were talking about a 12-year-old that we're trying to keep, he's in a diversion program to keep him out of the system. And we were talking about picking this young man up and where we had to pick him up from and all the things that had happened with his mom. And the man that was with me said, oh my goodness, that is me. He's like, for the first time talking about this story, he's like, I see how that led to this thing that led to this thing that led to me being incarcerated for 10 years. All of a sudden we had unpacked that. I was like, I'm not ready to, how do I address, like that's not my role. But he needed to tell his story. But what happens with that? So as we begin to do this, who's in the room, how they define that story, how they value it, what worth is put on it, because then the how people receive our stories then puts worth on us, right? If they say, oh, or if they blow it off, or if they're dismissive, all of that impacts that. So we've been actually working with Fania Davis and James Bell. Fania has done a lot of truth and reconciliation work across the globe and is doing that in San Francisco. And the harm and the pain that people have getting some folks to even want to be a member of this group has been challenging. Because when I tell my story, are you now going to use that to judge me? Mm-hmm. Right? And then a lot of times this idea of worthiness, right? So as we start to tell our truth, then the idea of reparations somehow becomes, well, you don't even deserve it. All of these things that we have to kind of unpack, address, and deal with. And I would just say, like, the investment of that, people don't want to invest in the story sometimes. Mm-hmm. The stories are the beginning of it, of getting to reparation. And I go back and forth in my own mind around, do I want repair or restoration? Do we want to be restored back to the glory that was before all these things? Or do we want to just repair some of the harm? I think about it in terms of houses, right? When you repair it, you fix it. But when you restore it, when you think about the Victorians, it's a very different kind of sense of that. And so I've been going back and forth when I look at some of the folks, the young people that we're working with. Do we want to repair that brokenness of that person, or do we want to restore the whole family? And those are the challenges that when you talk about the generational pieces, Cam, when you talk about that, I just keep thinking there's so much more to just this moment, this place, this time. And it's hard for folks because we've had a huge debate over if it's just about cash disbursements. Mm-hmm. Because the cash disbursements will be gone. And if we do not fix that system, we are not necessarily going to get to the place that we want to be. I've talked to John Burris, who is a civil rights attorney and does a lot of litigation, and he talks about how he can get somebody $5 million for a case, and 5 years later, they are still broken. Mm-hmm. The harm that was done is not repaired from the $5 million. Mm-hmm. And so thinking about that in this instance of, right, the money is important, but if hearts and spirits are still broken, if we don't unpack and hear the story, then we have only done not even a half of it. I think there's so much more to reparations than just the cash amount. And I think those stories help us get to that, because sometimes when we unpack the story, it wasn't just about a better school, it was about a better teacher, mm-hmm. right? And so if I give you money to go to private school and the private school teacher still treats you mm-hmm. like you are less than, then we're going to see some of the same cycles happening over and over again.
Robin Ruth Simmons, I want to ask, assuming that we figure out our stories, the next step is finding people who are invested in our narrative. How did you figure out allies and resources in implementing a program in Evanston?
And very important. I just
was really struck by what you said about finding a legal person to help.
Yes.
Everybody write that down.
Yes.
You need legal partners.
In the truth and reconciliation sort of conclusion to this discussion, I want to add that in it was February that I made the introduction of reparations, and that really took me actually physically to South Africa to learn more about truth and reconciliation. I'd heard so much about it. There had been some talk in the community about doing that and not reparations, and I wanted to be informed before I took a strong position on it. And while I was there, I found that after 20 years of this practice, it was a political season, campaigning was still on reparations. And so I really returned home with the position that reparations was the highest form of truth and reconciliation, really some tangible step towards repair. And we've seen that that's where we have been able to attract our partners, our allies, our folks that are contributing and building on the work. And we had, obviously, have told our story, our narrative has been shared. We have the luxury of having a Black History Archival Center in our city, Shorefront Legacy Center, and that really accelerated our reporting on reparations. We could refer people to Shorefront Legacy Center to learn more about our history instead of us tearfully resharing the lived experience of being a Black Evanstonian, when you can figure that out from the data. You can look and see the difference in our household income and our life circumstances and imagine what that might be like in our community. And so I was very focused on getting to repair in that year, 2019. And so in taking that legislative action, it called to action and held accountable the partners to step up. And I just want to lift up our faith community. It was mentioned by the professor, the faith community. And in Evanston, they have been our most important ally. The interfaith community, our synagogues, rabbis, and clergy in town have really stepped up, building a coalition to educate themselves and their congregations, writing white papers and essays and holding conferences on reparations and why. And just recently, on the 13th of June, just a couple days ago, held their first launch of their reparation initiative, where they are not only continuing to be informed, but now having their own independent giving campaign, giving reparations to a black organization, a reparations stakeholder authority of Evanston. And so in sharing the data and putting back to our allies and partners their values, hey partner, your values say that black lives matter and that you are for racial justice and healing and so on, and you see that you're failing because here are the race disparities, here is an action plan. So take it not so that it's so provocative. I've heard reparations is provocative. Here is an action plan that happens to be called reparations that will help you reach your goals and values. Won't you join us?
We're talking about partners and institutions and everybody who is culpable when we're approaching the topic of reparations. You mentioned yesterday the Boston City Council passed that resolution informally apologizing for slavery. It doesn't make any formal commitments, only theoretical ones. But in addition to agreeing to the idea of an apology, one of the things that they have in the resolution text is this idea of working to establish a truth and reconciliation registry. I read that and it struck me, and I want to invite you all to get creative with me a little bit. The text says, so that Bostonians who wish to express regret for past injustices can express their remorse. Have you guys seen that anywhere? And if so, what does it look like? And if not, what could it look like?
I have not. but the New Democracy Coalition, which pushed that forward with the counselors, mm-hmm. On city council, I think it's an interesting idea and a way that could extend the partnership that you were speaking about in collaboration and in building greater collaboration around the idea and the support in this process of education, because this continual education has to go on of ourselves and the broader community in that. And I mean that in the greatest sense, mm-hmm. of community. So I think that that's an interesting idea. But I have not seen it. I don't know if you have.
I haven't seen a registry.
A registry.
Nothing. All right. Another thing the resolution does, in theory, is to pledge to remove anti-black symbols in the city while developing opportunities to build structures that reflect racial repair and reconciliation. I'm thinking about removing statues on Monument Avenue in Richmond, Virginia. I'm thinking about Confederate flags coming down and statues going away everywhere. King Boston, I'm sure you guys know, is working to bring one of those here to the Boston Common. What sorts of symbols would you like to see when we're thinking beyond payment of cash and cultural change? Are there any symbols here in Boston, in San Francisco, or anywhere in California, anywhere nationally?
Well. So, I mean, we have symbols throughout our society in many ways that we don't even know are identified. Dudley Square, I mean, this is for Boston. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Dudley Square, which is Nubian Square. You grow up with a relationship to a space or a building, Faneuil Hall. Mm-hmm. And we can go back here as a historic city, and the names and the implications of the relationship of all of the people. This is how the conversation even began at Harvard about the names on the buildings or the symbols, the meaning of the symbols on the logo.
The university seal.
Yes, yep. The seal. And we can go on and on about the street names, the park names, the school names in the heart of the black community. so this is in part what the work of the commission would be to help us, in better understanding our own story as a community. We walk by the graveyards up in Upham's Corner. You don't even know who's buried in there. And that, in fact, the people that were buried in there were some of those who had been those who had been enslaved and served Harvard. The document that was produced by Harvard, it's a very interesting study as a document, a historic document. It's got 500-600 footnotes. I mean, if you want to dig into research, you know, I'm a researcher, mm-hmm. right? I mean, just an understanding and better understanding our own story. But this is part of our lived experience here. And so the reason we propose the commission, yes, it's to engage, as California has done and so forth, and to explore the questions of how we might monetize some of that, but it is far deeper than this. And I hope our conversation is helping to share an understanding of that we need to have the time and the space and the resources to better understand, to do the research on how our city, what it looks like, mm-hmm. and how we can begin to transform that. And it takes a period of reflection. Mm-hmm. Just as a side note, I had happened to spend some time teaching in New Orleans. And I had to have a meeting with someone, and, oh, well, meet me at the cafe. Where's the cafe? The cafe is on Jefferson Davis Boulevard. Okay, well. Okay. I couldn't understand that. I'm from Detroit. lived in Boston on my Jefferson Davis Boulevard.
Mm-hmm. Where are we going?
In public, we're gonna be there, right? It's like, but when you live that, sometimes things are right in front of us and we don't see it. Mm-hmm. We don't understand it. In the way that some other eyes can help us. You spoke about lens. This question of lens is so very important in helping us clear our own lenses to our own environment. And I appreciate so much what King Boston is doing. And now having taken this discussion, not just from a physical monument, which is important mm-hmm. in this truth telling, but now going beyond that, let's do the research. Let's have a research. And let's do the organizing that needs to be coupled with research in order to have action.
I mean, I would just say on top of the research, right, like there's a piece of this that's like the cost analysis, mm-hmm. right? Because when we start talking about reparations and the actual cost to fully do that, mm-hmm. You talk about street signs, right? Like that is a cost. If you go through and count up all the streets that have names that probably they should not. The cost of changing those street names, and people don't get that it's not just the sign, it's like all the maps and all the other things, right? So that added cost becomes a huge piece. Even with the monuments, in San Francisco we had, which has happened across the nation, monuments being toppled, right? Or even before they're toppled, having them moved out of places and then stored. And then you find out you're spending $100,000 a month to move these monuments into a building to store them. And it's like, is that the way that we want the reparations dollars to be used for moving statues and monuments? And, you know, I think I've really wrestled with also this idea, it may be a pass sometimes to move some of these things and not have folks have to own what was out there. Right, and so what's the education process? Because I agree, we have a historian who likes to remind us about the Fillmore Street, which is in the heart of a black community. It's in the part that's called the Harlem of the West. And having people understand how President Fillmore felt about black folks and having this education around that. And at the same time, we have people like Mary Ellen Pleasance, who was in San Francisco, who was giving money for the Underground Railroad that nobody knows about in San Francisco, right? So there are the things where, like, how do we elevate and amplify those things, but also call out without it costing black folks to redo the harm of those streets and those names and making sure that folks understand who so many of these things are named after, because the same thing, they're claiming, so many of these folks are claiming neighborhoods in the name of people that didn't like black folks, right? Like they're like, I'm from this neighborhood, I'm from this set, I live on this block. Mm-hmm. And they have no idea what that represents. And so for me, you know, making sure that we understand the cost, because I don't want when they count up the cost of reparations and we try to make sure that it gets to people that they're like, oh, well, we spent $20 million on redoing the streets. You know, so like those are the things that the research, the cost analysis, and the education that's happening. I would just say the main thing for me, and I've wrestled with this because when they talk about naming of schools and all the other things, the society that exists right now has very different values than the society that may exist 50 years, 100 years from now. And so how are we preparing to make sure that when a new culture, a new tradition, something comes out, that the work that's being done right now also doesn't get erased? And that's something we've been really working hard with the legislation. We don't need it to be based on whether Shirley Weber or Gavin Newsom are in leadership at the state level of California, or that London Breed is the mayor of San Francisco. We don't want that, you know, 4 years from now or 20 years from now, a new elected person comes in and can just undo all of that. So I think those are the things that I really am like, how do we make sure that this is bigger than any one personality and that it's legislated in a way that if somebody wanted to undo it, it would take just as long to undo it as it did to actually put it into place.
One of the things I think ensures that is the continued education. Yemisi gave us that proverb about cultivating our knowledge like a garden. I'm thinking about some of the things that I watched in order to prepare for our conversation, and I saw Randall Robinson on C-SPAN in 2000, and you're already chuckling because you know he's got this deep voice and he's very poised and he has so much knowledge. He's quoting Greek scholars and all these references to law, and he's taking these phone calls from very ignorant people suggesting what he ought not to say and what he ought to go read. And it occurred to me, the people who are coming up behind y'all aren't going to be in the education space and tolerate that abuse. I think generationally, folks who are like my age are like, no, we're not doing that anymore. Talk a little bit about what is keeping you guys motivated and the advice that you have for the people coming up behind you who want to stay in the work, want to stay in the education, want to prompt people with histories that help us think about repairing harm, but do not want to take the abuse that we've endured. Robin, I'll start with you.
Sure. Our conditions keep me motivated. Waking up and the pandemic, the coronavirus, and how that impacted further our conditions is keeping me motivated. But I can say that public education was so necessary and probably the most important component of the work that we did ongoing. We had town hall meetings where we had national thought leaders, Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee and other more notable advocates like Danny Glover and other academics come and have ongoing panel discussions and town halls, and then were very generous with their time, allowing access and coming to our committee meetings, and Cam Howard often coming for public comment, and even using the work in Evanston to inspire his book, Laying the Foundation for Local Reparations. And so we continue to have ongoing education, but for those that are coming behind us, yes, a lot less patient, you know, a lot more agitated and ready for repair now, and less willing to be diplomatic and patient. And to them, you know, I actually share their frustration, but I found that it's not been productive to be in constant sort of debate and just make a case that is strong and viable and valid and continue to do the work and stay encouraged. And, you know, I don't know that I always have the words for the younger generation. And I don't know that it's a problem that they are responding in the way that they are. I think all of us, all the ways that we come to the work and the way that we push and pull and inform are getting us to this incredible place of momentum that we're at right now. So the younger generation has joined the conversation with a different spirit and energy, and we have more co-sponsors ever in the House. We have a Senate companion bill. We have the first year of celebrating Juneteenth as a federal, you know, holiday. And so I don't know that it is anything that we need to push back on. I think that it's all really working together for the good.
I mean, just to piggyback on that, I really feel like it's the inside-outside game we talk about so much, right? Because in some ways, the angry folks make it easier for folks to be like, well, let me talk to the not so angry people about how to make this right, right? Like, we need that push and for lack of a better term, that fear, right? Of like, what's gonna happen if we're not responsive? And so I think that's important, but for me, what gets me going, like I think back now to all the things I didn't enjoy as a child growing up, you know, like sitting in church and maybe I don't go as much as I used to, or the nasty little piece of peppermint candy that came out of my grandmother's purse, right? But that at that moment in time, I was really happy for and I put it. And now I look back and I'm like, they were preparing, right? They knew it was gonna be a long day. They knew it was gonna be hot. They knew we were gonna be agitated. And so I think about it in terms of Maya Angelou's bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. Mm-hmm. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. So what are the gifts that I leave behind? Right. I want to make sure that when I'm gone, that I wasn't a waste of space. Mm-hmm. Right. That I wasn't a waste of potential or opportunity. I want to make sure that afterwards there is some sense, you know, my son may not appreciate it now, but later he might be like, oh, she made some sense sometime. You know, like, I just think that that is like, what's the legacy? What's the hope? Because now I look back at my grandparents and their contemporaries and their folks, and I'm like, I want to make sure that somebody has some level of fondness for what I did, that it was bigger than me.
You got candy in your purse now.
Look, I did not learn the lesson well, let me just say. I forget gum and candy and all the things.
Dr. Kumara, those coming up behind you, less patient, less tolerating of the ignorance and the nonsense, what do you tell them?
Continue to be less patient, less tolerant. And they're the ones that give me hope. Mm-hmm. You give me hope. King Boston, I mean, the young leadership that has put this together, the thought of putting a week like this together gives me incredible hope. So much so, I might even go back and teach again next year. Because when I go to class, with all the other things going on in my institution, when I go into class and the people, young people with whom I deal, they give me hope. And it is then the work that they've done, the pressure that they have placed on these institutions, the challenge to the university symbol that produced the report. And then you see now coming forward this notion of, well, there is some culpability that we have. There was collusion that we have had. Now, how are we going to grapple with it? That's their responsibility to help push that question, the challenge. Because it is really ultimately the issue that we're raising and that has been the sacrifice made by so many on whose shoulders we stand, who are now the potential salvation for what this country can become. Can it live up to the ideals on which this was established? Mm-hmm. Even though there were the contradictions by the very people who established it, and we understand. Can we live up to it? And we're the ones who call that question. Mm-hmm. And in addition, there is this linkage now that I'm seeing as our world, because of technology and our ability to move and engage with one another and our local communities and so forth, is becoming smaller and smaller. And there are people of African descent who now have state power. We haven't talked too much about that here. But you see, one of the real challenges of this reparations movement, this movement of repair, fundamentally comes back to where the Reverend began the conversation. Mm-hmm. It's a question of land. And we don't have, Barack Obama, no Barack Obama, we have not had state power in this country. It's about power. And there are now countries with leadership of African descent that are raising this question? And why are they at the bottom of the human development index? And they're raising it to those who were the former colonizers. Hmm. And it's the young people there that are asking their leadership, why are you reproducing the system that they left? We need to re-envision who we are as countries, collaboratively in the Caribbean, on the continent of Africa. And we're beginning to engage with them now, our young people here, this next generation, with that generation, asking those hard questions, not only of those who have power, but of ourselves. That's my hope.
I'm gonna ask a hard one now and then open it up for, clap it up for Dr. Kumar. I'm gonna ask a hard one now and invite anybody that wants to ask a question to our microphones in the aisles. I think there is going to be a point of disagreement here. I know that in California, the task force or your state commission decided on a lineage standard for who gets reparations and how. I know in Evanston, you guys decided on a time period of people and direct descendants. I know you're thinking about global framing. So I'll put it to you like this. Sandy Darity, we heard a little bit about the $14 trillion estimate. I think it's $840,000 per household on average. That's the math. But the people who would be eligible, the community of eligibility, would be determined by being able to prove that you're directly related to a U.S. descendant of a slave and that you've identified as Black for more than a decade. I think he says 12 years. What do we think about Darity's math, and what do we think about Darity's standards for who is eligible? Anyone first?
I will say we hosted Michael Harriet, who writes for The Griot, recently, and he was talking a little bit about this, it's nice to hear the 12 years standard, but he was saying, basically, when you think about Thomas Jefferson's family and one side decided to be white, live as white, and one side, that we basically are opening this up in some way. So that's one challenge. For me, we have gone back and forth, when we did the $60 million allocation for Black folks in San Francisco, we heard quickly from our African immigrants, right, that we needed to understand that when they get stopped by the police, they don't say to them, are you African or are you African American? Mm-hmm. And so we had to pivot. We had to be responsive, right, because a Black man in a hoodie is a Black man in a hoodie no matter where he was born. And so we've been really having these conversations at a community level around that. And I would say, similar, as I mentioned earlier, similar to Evanston, thinking about it a lot with regards to the education system, the incarceration, the justice system by and large, and this discussion around housing and who had access to it. Right, like we still have things on the book, neighborhoods on the books that say you can't sell this house to somebody Black, right? So there's a lot to do there, and it doesn't say Black American, it says Black, period. Mm. And so that for us, we'll see, the statewide has made their decision, but I do not believe that the San Francisco body is going to go the same way, because San Francisco in and of itself is so small in terms of the Black population, but so diverse.
Robin Rue, talk about your standard in Evanston and how you arrived at that.
Sure. I just want to say personally, I'm Pan-African. I'm rooting for everybody Black. But on a legislative level, we identified a harm. And I think Cam says everyone Black harmed in America, same thing. Mm-hmm. Everyone Black harmed in Evanston by this law is eligible for reparations. And between 1919 and 69 and those descendants, the whole diaspora is in Evanston. And we have a rich Black community. And so we don't have any lineage standards at all. Black is Black in Evanston. And then I'll say, I think it's a very hyper-local discussion also. And so you look at a city like Cam is leading, Chicago, a city that is founded by a Black man, a Haitian immigrant Black man. You know, are you going to exclude, you know, his descendants, mm-hmm. you know, from a reparation program. So in Evanston, we're just implementing our eligibility based on the harm, and everybody Black was harmed.
I already know what you're going to tell me. Nobody was untouched by colonization. While he's winding up his answer, do we have any? I don't see anybody at our microphone. So, oh, we have one. Do you want to go quickly?
You answered it for me.
All right. All right, let's go.
This question is for actually Dr. Kumar, and anybody else can jump in on it as well. But specifically in Boston, we notice, and it could be around the world, that post-George Floyd, there was this separation of the, how could I say it, the seniors, or those that have sort of paved the way, and there was this notion that the young people had the energy, and you know they didn't hold the line. And so in this conversation, and to your point earlier about like legacy, and you said the young people continue to be impatient and whatnot, how do we make this, and it's a kind of presumptive statement, but how do we ensure we make this reparations conversation continually relevant to this generation? Because some of the sentiment of the younger people were, you know, you all were out here trying to do it 20, 30 years ago, and we're still working for it, it didn't happen. And so now they don't want us to pass the baton. They're not even worried about the baton anymore. And so how do we tie the energy of the younger with this, with the present things that are going on as well? Dr. Kumar.
This issue of intergenerational collaboration is critically important, and how we reproduce our movement has been one that we have to continually grapple with. I'm not gonna say that I have the answer on that. But rather it is something that we must continue to struggle with. We must continue to, you know, just as within some of our structured organizations, whether we like it or not, they talk about DEI, but we have to do that in our movement. And that means including young people in the leadership. You know, we have to listen to the voices and allow young people to execute and consciously do that. This is one of the dynamics that happened or didn't happen, you know, in the civil rights movement. And this reproduction, this conscious reproduction or lack thereof. We have to do this in a conscious way, this inclusiveness. We're trying, but it has to be both ways. And also, I think lessons from others. Well, it's been interesting in observing the reparations movement globally. One of the things that has been very interesting about the way in which it's happened in the Caribbean has been the conscious inclusion of cultural artists in the movement, and the use of arts, humanity, literature, plays, theater, coming from out of the creativity of those who might somewhat other in other contexts have been isolated in our community. Using the media forms that we have, including that as part of this continued process, not only of education, which is important, but also of leadership.
Can I piggyback on that to just say two things when you talk about inclusion that I really appreciate? One is that we've been very intentional about the artists, and so we were able to have a couple of plays and musicals and some spoken word done specifically in that regard. And the other thing that we've been really challenged on and are gonna be much more intentional over the next year is around intersectionality and how we talk about the LGBT community within Black spaces. You know, that has been a real challenge because a lot of times Black queer folks are like, you know, I'm not accepted in the queer community, I'm not accepted in the Black community, and we've got to do a better job in that regard in terms of inclusion in these conversations and understanding if you are Black, queer, and poor, that it's a whole other level of engaging in society. And so we're trying to be very intentional in that regard.
Just to add, I love and appreciate the question. When we met in December, there were about 50 of us that met in December, local leaders, and that was the feedback from a few of the younger folks there. We actually need like workshops on intergenerational leadership. They were asking for that. because, okay, it's happening here too. Yes, and so they were actually like fascinated that I was getting along so well with the elders. And so depending on what space I'm in, I'm either young or old mm-hmm. or whatever. And so in this instance, like I was able to tell them, like that's what has accelerated my thinking and leadership, engaging with the elders and leading. And but some of the elders aren't always that warm and inviting right. in the space too. That's not the case here, as you know, and we hope that you teach a class. But that has happened, and so it's really going to take work on the movement, the sort of the leadership, to be more intentional in inviting young folks, because their innovation, their thinking, their enthusiasm and energy is necessary for us to build on where we're at today. And so I don't know who's going to write the workshop, but it's been requested by the younger folks in the movement that there is some thinking and teaching. And then also one thing that was a total learning for me is sort of African-centered sort of living and mm-hmm. leading and proper ways to respect and honor the elders. Yep. And so, you know, I misstepped a couple times early on, but was very coachable and asking to be educated so that I embrace that culture as well. And I think that it comes across as an offense, but it's just that some folks aren't informed. Mm-hmm. And I grew up as black as anybody in Evanston, but not in that tradition, which seems to be a prominent sort of culture in the reparations movement.
Mm-hmm. We've got a question in the back.
My question is about reparations around wealth at the community and the institutional level. For example, how do we address that the roads in West Roxbury get repaired, but not in Roxbury? Mm-hmm. How do we address that our black faculty, our professors, are not getting tenured, or that they get severed differently than white professors? And do we need an oversight committee? Should our city councilors be doing this, or do we need a human rights commission in every municipality?
It sounds like she's asking about keeping us accountable.
Yes, the issue of both public sector as well as institutional accountability is really a very central question. I teach in a public institution. And I'm gonna be real specific. The Africana Studies Department, which mm-hmm. I'm currently the chair at UMass Boston, 2017 had 7 full-time tenure track faculty, 2 of whom that year did not get tenure. Today, the Africana Studies Department has 1.5 mm-hmm. full-time tenure track faculty. And a search for 2 new faculty members was just canceled in March by a black dean. Mm. Now, there are institutional issues, and it's going to be addressed. We're going to do that. But the community writ large doesn't really understand fully, and it's our fault, the kind of power that they have. This is a public institution that has hundreds of millions of dollars being channeled in it from a public sector and is allowing this to happen, while simultaneously it is saying it's an institution that wishes to stand on becoming an anti-racist, health-promoting institution. Mm. A direct contradiction. And it's living it out through its administration now. We can't allow that to happen. And this is after having had it turn out its black chancellor several years ago. Those of you here from Boston, you know what I'm talking about. But that's on us in not holding that institution fully accountable, and we must do that. The same way, if the roads in your community are not being repaired, we now have a city council that is far more reflective of our broader community than we have ever since I've lived in Boston. You need to take that there and exercise our power from our neighborhoods and as community residents who pay taxes here. My street needs to be repaired. We have a certain kind of power within us that's one, unorganized, and secondly, does not move to structure accountability of the institutions that we support. That's on us to do that work and to take up that challenge. And I would love to be able to call on you to help us at this institution with regard to this very specific question of the Africana Studies Department. But these broader challenges, we have to continue to do that local level organizing and use those, as you're saying, inside while we're outside in order to pressure for the kinds of change that we deserve in our community.
We've got another question in the back.
Yes. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So what would you say, Dr. Kamara and Ms. Simmons, Ms. Davis, if you were countersued by those of us who have 4 or 5+ generations in this country, being skipped over again, like the Japanese were given 25,000, being skipped over by those who have barely been in this country, and cannot show all of the duress and all sorts of illegal things that happen. What do you say? What are you going to say about that if there becomes a group that decides to countersue you?
You mean of African American descendants who are frustrated about the broader application of reparations?
I think there is much more discussion to have on the lineage argument or the question at a federal level or in those communities that were slave states and municipalities, and that once the task force is established, the HR 40 task force is established, that will be sorted out. There may be remedies specific to those that have lineage and versus those that had experienced harm that were, you know, post Jim Crow era. But I do believe that there's more discussion to be had at a federal level. But in terms of it being a question at a local level in the communities that we've been working with, and now it's over a couple dozen, I feel very strongly that the case is everyone black. You are registered as black, you are identified as black on site, and discriminated against or over-policed or whatever those circumstances are. And I feel very strongly that it would be difficult to have a lineage-based argument at a local level.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think that there is a legal precedent that, you know, you're going to go back to those people, those groups of people who brought those people out of Africa and put them in a situation of harm. And so it's going to become like an international legal situation.
What about this idea of hitting up all the colonizers? I think this is what Sis is saying.
Up to those people in the Caribbean, I think it's wonderful what Barbados has done. And, you know, I think that they have set a precedent that, you know, other people in Jamaica and all of the other islands can follow, as well as people in Latin America, and the Portuguese legal precedent. We're talking about law. And
right.
I think that we have to be very careful. I mean, I look at how African Americans have really been pimped in this country.
Sis, you're gonna get Dr. Kamara talking again, and we gotta wrap up.
we need to be listening to Dr. Kamara and others who have been doing this for a long time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's very important that young people hear about this. And what I really miss here in Boston is Freedom School. Underground railroad sessions where people can talk freely in a atmosphere that is away from the academy, that is in the community. We've always done this. I mean, look at this crazy situation we have going on now with white parents all over America screaming that they don't want their children to know the real true history of this country.
Right.
And trying to blame it on critical race theory.
I'll just add that I don't think we have any debate among us. But as a NARC commissioner, we work very closely with CARICOM. And I would just offer maybe becoming familiar with the 10-point plan at NARC and that of CARICOM as well. CARICOM actually was at our local reparations conference that was in December where we were all convened. Eric Phillips actually was there representing from Guyana, South America. So we are, you know, a part of a global struggle. And I feel very strongly that there will be more robust debate on that once the HR 40 commission is established.
Don't be fooled. It's all about money. It all comes down to money.
Okay, thank you.
So, you know, even if you've only been here for 5 years, the reason why you came here was money.
Thank you. All right. We got to wrap this up. Our time is done. Robin Ruth Simmons, Cheryl Evans Davis, Dr. Jemadari Kamara, thank you so much.
Thank you.